remember every single year in elementary school, we used to make Father's Day cards. Someone would always say, you know, Daniel doesn't have a dad. I remember my mom told me one time that I used to wash my face and not like dry my face with a towel, and she said, your father always did that. He would have been so scared. And I just wonder, what was he thinking? Was he thinking about me?
My wife and I walked down to my sister's house for a game of cards that night. And we were both, like many other people, of course, looking at the storm. And I do recall saying, you know, that I feel sorry for anybody who's at sea tonight, because it must have been a nightmarish night at sea.
I remember it was a vicious night. And I thought about it that night, and I said, boy, I hope that storm is not out there.
I was doing the ice and the weather, and I mean, we were looking at the forecast. I mean, it was certainly calling for, you know, an enormously strong, you know, blow. It turned out to be just horrific. I mean, it was just such a massive storm.
I spoke to the radio operator who was coming on nights, and the ranger. And he told me how he went in and sat down with the weatherman that evening, and he was looking at the anemometer, and he said she went up to 115 knots before she started backing off, you know. So they had it a bit worse than what we did.
It was an awful storm that night, and in fact, it shook the building. So I woke up at that point at about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I thought to myself, I said, where the hell would I be now if I was out on the oil rig? And I immediately answered the question. I said, I'd be hovel behind some kind of a windbreak, wishing to God I wasn't there.
Well, I went off and I went to supper. While at supper, we got hit with the big wave. And the drilling foreman on the ranger called the drilling foreman on our rig. And he mentioned then about the porthole being smashed with the seas. And some water getting into the electrical system, and alarms going off, and everybody running around, and people were pretty excited.
Back then they had a paper chart and a pen, and I mean the scale on the paper wasn't big enough to account for this wave. I mean, the needle just would go up and just stay at the top of the paper and just be up there for 4 or 5 seconds before it would start to drop. I understand that that was the same wave that broke the porthole on the Ocean Ranger. That was 6 miles away.
I just had a call from the Ocean Ranger. The rig is listing to the bow. It's on the Hibernia J-34 location.
It's the Ocean Ranger and Hibernia J-34 listing which way?
Listing to the bow. And they're down 8 to 10 feet. They're trying to ballast, trying to isolate what the problem is, but so far they haven't been able to make it. They just don't know where the problem is. They're sure in a bind right now.
Yeah.
Search and Rescue on the phone right now. They're listening to you. Can you give us anything else on it right now?
Okay. Weather out here is blowing in there. Blowing about 70, anywhere 75 to 80 miles an hour. And we're listing badly, and we need to get the people off the rig, and that's about it.
Roger. Did you get that all right?
Yeah, what's wind direction?
Roger, Jack, could you get us the wind direction, please? The wind direction, over.
Over, Roger, stand by.
What about supply boats out there?
Say again?
What about supply boats out there?
Yeah. That's it. Say again, direction, Jack?
West, and it's 70 or 70 to 80.
Roger, westerly, 70 to 80 knots. How many boats have you got on location right now, over?
Three boats total.
You got a total of three boats, over.
All right.
My buddy came in and he's a command. He said, "We've got to get on deck." Yeah, right. He said, "No," he said, "the Ocean Ranger just gave out an SOS. Mayday."
One of my friends was out in the hallway. He came along to me and he called me aside and he said, "Our buddy there, his two brothers are over on that rig."
What I just know was the most severe storm that I was ever out in, you know. And I had an idea that if we were getting hit with big waves and sustaining damage, that they probably were too, you know. The medic came along and he was kind of more or less, you know, I don't think it was so bad when there were people around talking to me, you know, but when I was kind of by myself, it seemed to be worse. So he came along and he gave me some kind of tranquilizers or something, I guess it was.
He put in an awful night. You know, there was nothing but bad news was coming over the radio. And he was there to hear it all.
Back then, I mean, we didn't have anything. We didn't have all the survival suits like they have now. We had nothing, you know? I mean, you were just going to go out in the Atlantic Ocean. I mean, the seawater temperature was minus 1.2, I think. You know, there was freezing spray. You know, the wind was blowing 100 miles an hour. There was, you know, enormous, you know, it was a tremendous amount of snow.
And, of course, it's dark, and it's windy, and it's howling, and it's cold, and there's nobody around.
The Seaford Highlander said she had a lifeboat with men in her. Seaford Highlander was there, and we were here, and the lifeboat was in between, and the lifeboat was working her way to the Seaford Highlander.
Well, the first sign of life I seen in the lifeboat was when she was on her port quarter. There was a flashlight or something turned on in inside the lifeboat, there was illumination inside. That's when the report was made to the 706 that there were survivors at that time.
It was at least two men, one on the starboard side, one on the port side, bailing water. You could see the water trolling out of it.
I knew he was saying something to us, and I was trying to listen, and then the wind and everything, but I'm sure that he said something about engines and that we're taking on water. Help us, please, like that.
Whitecliff fired his life ring, and Buddy caught it and made it fast to the stern of that life raft on the port side as far as he could get it on the railing.
And did you throw your life ring?
Yes, sir. Another fella come out, he got on the stern of her, and he caught it, and he did the same thing, put it on the port side as far as he could get it. You could hear him yelling out, you know, like singing out to you. But she was all right until they got, we had her tied on. Yeah. As soon as we got her tied on, they all piled out. I don't know if they had her, figured we had her safe or not.
When the lines were made fast, all the crew come out of her, probably seven or eight, probably more, and she tipped over. The boat tipped over within a matter of a couple of seconds.
And at that time, the boat was how close to the Seaforth Islander?
Maybe 3 or 4 feet away.
But then we went down in the swell, and when we came up there, there was, how would I describe it? It was like a bunch of new stars in the water. The lifeboat overturned, and all the men got out. So I guess all their lights and their life jackets activated.
Well, when she rolled over, they were all under her, and then they climbed up, they come out on each side of her, and try and climb up, back up on her again.
Then after a while, they just start, you know, falling off and just floating around. And you can hear the guys scream for help and things, I guess. They were pretty rough on us.
We got close enough to see people. We did. And trying to get boat hooks out to them, do like that, and reach out and try to get a hook into a bit of clothing or something, because I don't say they were last long in the cold night like that. Well, we got boat hooks out, but like I said, when you reach out and you're just about to get them, you'll have to drop the hook or hold on to the hook and then grab a hold of something and hold on for a second. The wave will come take you, right? But we got close enough to see people, right? So they put the lights on, but they just couldn't get them.
Some were face down, some were just there in the water. I remember one in particular, just the face, I can still see it now. It was just like it was looking at you. But we tried to recover him. The weather conditions were just too bad at the time.
Thank you.
I left the rig that morning, before daylight, I kind of had an idea that there were no survivors. When I got on the chopper going in, it was that kind of empty feeling, you know? And that seemed to be about the worst of it.
We got him sealed on the chopper and sent him home. He was in before his parents woke up and got the news.
And of course, when I landed, I knew I had to go tell Dad. It was kind of hard to tell him. But he paced the floor a lot. And I guess he knew. And that was it.
We're just going down for a walk, dear.
I remember waking up and going out into the living room, and my mother was sitting in a rocking chair, and she was very quiet. And I guess I sensed something wrong, and I asked her, and she said to me that they had lost contact with the Ocean Ranger, and this was probably maybe 7:30 in the morning.
That morning, I got a call, and here was my boss. He said, we have a problem out on the rig. And I said, oh, no, I just came out. I just came home. So I said, I don't have to go out again. He said, no, something is more serious. He said, get down to your sister-in-law's as fast as you can and wait for the phone calls. I knocked on the door, and she was just, I think she just tripped in something over the floor, and she had the radio on, and she went, she just went nuts.
I got a call from a friend in Corner Brook. And I answered the phone, and he said, oh, Bruce, you're there, thank heavens. And, you know, he was in tears.
I got up that morning and I put on the radio and my husband went to work. I put on the radio and it said it was an oil rig in trouble, but it didn't say the name, and it really didn't mean too much to me the first time that I heard it.
My mother was pregnant at the time. I remember there was a crowd of family around her.
I was strongly of the belief that if my son or anyone's family had any problems like that, you would be notified. And we weren't, not in the way that I would expect to be.
Air, Sea, and Rescue have been unable to locate the Ocean Ranger. The site has been identified by helicopter through its anchor buoys and wave rider buoys. Two lifeboats have been sighted. One was capsized and the other was stern down. A partially inflated life raft was also sighted. Bodies have been spotted in the water, but there is no indication at this time as to whether there are any survivors.
So when a few hours after, when they start giving out saying they believe the 84 men were lost, I called Search and Rescue in Halifax and actually argued with them, telling them that they didn't know what they were talking about because no one let me know, and I just thought that this couldn't happen.
It's my very, very sad duty to tell you officially the Ocean Ranger is lost.
And then we saw his name roll up on the television screen. And up to that time, no one had called us. And that still haunts me.
Thank you.
I was just devastated. I knew that this thing was going to happen. I knew that things were so bad out there. And I couldn't get my head around the fact that I knew it.
I can picture my, at that time she would have been the three-year-old daughter on the phone that day and the next, the days after the February 15th, on a toy phone and that, pretending to be talking to her friends and say, some of Dad's friends are in trouble, they need help and things like that. I mean, these are sort of raw emotions, you know, that just stay with you, you know.
I was involved in it once the bodies were brought in from the boat and put into the old Pier 17. One of the men who had been working on the Ranger, who was a pretty good friend of mine, Gordon Noseworthy, he volunteered to come and identify because he knew 80 on site.
I'd go through and here was a beautiful white sheets draped up in, you know, sort of in cubicle type things. Shaking, you know. Not very often you see an awful lot of bodies in a certain time, especially, you know, guys that you work with, you know, and they're just lying there. One or two of them weren't wearing anything, just their inside shorts. So I would say these guys had moved fast. A fair number of them just had regular street clothes, and as if they just went to sleep. A couple of them had their eyes open.
And that was a difficult thing for Gordon Noseworthy, because he had to go through the whole process and didn't know when the next body would be his brother.
I told the Mounties, and I said, now my brother is wearing all white, but if there's a guy in white clothes, describe him to me before I see him, and then I'll go in. And if he's a chunky man, he's my brother. So a stocky man, but he never showed up. My mother still always thought he was on an island somewhere, you know, just waiting to come home. So, and I think up to her death 4 years ago, she still believed that.
A number of people actually did carry that fantasy for a while. Another situation I recall of a family is where this particular woman set a place at her table for a number of weeks, almost as a last desperate attempt, that her husband, she would come in one night and actually find him sitting at the table eating his dinner.
He was always very quick. He was a small man. He was strong. And I guess he was in charge of a lifeboat to some extent. And he always said that if there was ever a problem, his group would be the first ones off. I do recall hearing that they had found his body. I remember a funeral. It was a big crowd and a lot of family. And a lot of people worried about my mother being 6 months pregnant at the time.
Then we got into a waiting period, not knowing what we were going to face. There was no one to make me believe that we were going to have a funeral, and I found that very, very difficult.
There were occasionally people that, women or even parents that I would come across, they'd still have a hope. Even around even getting a body back, you know, not even just about the death, but even I need the body. And so you had that feeling until they had the body, there still was a hope that was there.
Every day I was thinking someone was going to come and tell me that this is just a dream or they made a mistake.
I think that was the overriding thing that I found in the families. They wanted somebody to be made responsible. They wanted somebody held responsible. They wanted to find out whose fault was it, because they were convinced it was somebody's fault.
They didn't have a face. Even if they could figure out whose fault it was, they didn't have a face. They didn't have a human being they could look at and say, you were the guy who killed my husband. You had to be really stupid not to see that the safety regime at the time was very, very inadequate. And in some ways, understandably so. In some ways. Because we had an industry that landed on our shores that had its roots elsewhere. It was typified by tough, hard-headed, steel-toed guys who really didn't care all that much about safety because that's not where their heads were at. These were guys making hole and getting oil, liquid gold out. And we loved that at the time.
I mean, it was known amongst everyone working offshore as the ocean danger. I mean, they were regularly taking people out to the galley, for example, and putting them on the drill floor. And I mean, without proper training, you know, without, you know, proper supervision. The first week I was on the Ocean Ranger, they put a young fellow from the galley on the drill floor and he chopped off 3 fingers in a pipe tongs.
There wasn't a general team spirit. There was a push from the top down to work harder and work faster. And that was my first indication that this was not, you know, not a safe place to work in.
They came by and saw you walking from A to B, they would bark at you as if you were an animal.
It seemed like every American out there was a boss, and even if he wasn't from your department, you had to listen or the trail will just trickle and, you know, go home, so you listen.
And they got mad at me for being conscientious, and inevitably I was called down to the tool pusher's office. And this tool pusher sat in his chair and he said, Christopher, you got to learn to keep your mouth shut, boy. We're going to run you off this rig.
these men weren't properly trained. And the awful story of the reconstruction that was put together of when this rig was sinking and they were turning these valves, it became clear in the evidence that every action they took only served to guarantee that the rig would in fact capsize, because they were doing it wrongly.
It's frightening to think of it in hindsight, you know, the responsibility that one had, that one wasn't at all prepared for, trained for.
I think the people who were in charge of that rig weren't ready for the North Atlantic. And so in a sense, you can almost, looking at it, almost seems like maybe they were cavalier. You know, they took things a bit too relaxed. I don't even think our government knew what they were dealing with. You know, that's why you had gaps in the legislation around safety.
Safety meetings were just that word. You know, put it in someone's logbook, that discussion of this, discussion of that. But when are we going to get cod tongues, or, you know, when are we going to have new movies? We're going to get new games, new darts, and you know, that was the usual thing. But that was a safety meeting.
In the Navy, I'd done lifeboat drills, you know, out. You would just do them until you couldn't do them anymore, and still people would make mistakes. But that was how you learned. And here there was no learning curve. You know, those boats existed up on the deck, 80 feet above the water. And I never once saw the David's move. They would just take note of the people that showed up at the lifeboats, and then the formality was done.
There was really no chance, and you know, that was the tragedy of it. When we look back and think, well, you know, if people had survival suits, I mean, I'm sure some of them, you know, would have lived. I mean, not all of them, but I'm sure some of them would have made it.
Oil was our dream, right? Oil was our dream. That's where our future, that's where we're going to get rich. We were going to be okay. And there was a fair amount of frenzy in pursuit of that. And the safety and welfare of the people who were working on that rig really was at the bottom of the totem pole.
Boy, if we didn't learn from this, we need our arses kicked. This was a tragic accident made up of many, many mistakes by many, many people, by many, many authorities, by many, many governments. And boy, if we haven't learned something from this, we shouldn't be out there now drilling.
I do believe in talking to people in the industry, I do believe that safety, in fact, does have a higher priority. I don't think there's any question about that.
There's a lot more safety involved, right? Like, if a person don't know nowadays, it's his own fault, because the courses are there for the person to learn, right? And if you're nervous at this racket, don't go at it.
If there's anything can be learned from this, is that safety should be first, and it wasn't then at that time. And I guess if people realize what this was all about, there'd be nobody out there working, especially under those conditions.
You know, they've gone through great lengths to find and make it a safer place to work.
I'm sure that probably never again in the history of oil drilling in the province or will there be somebody of my limited training operating, you know, the ballast control room of a floating platform. Or, I mean, I don't think there's any doubt about that, that they've taken these things much more seriously. I just assume, I mean, if they haven't, then really it's insane.
It does need to be part of our psyche, because we can't forget, because when we forget, that's when another tragedy can happen, you know, and that's why we can't forget.
It is a very expensive price to pay, and the main thing, I guess, is we don't forget who paid the price.
He was back on another one of his trips, really, because he had come home a number of times, and he stayed with his mother in St. John's. And we'd come out to visit, or he'd come out and visit us. Shortly afterwards, there seemed like a little bit of a better relationship between them. And then at one point we were on a little trip, a little outing together, the whole family, mother and father. And we were up on this field. There were sheep and stuff around, a friend's farm. And a couple of us were looking down over the field, and we saw our mother and father kiss. And of course, that was a real exciting time, because you know, your mom and dad are kissing. They ended up remarrying, which was a tremendous thing for to watch your parents get remarried. And things seemed to get really good.
My grandmother tells me that I look a lot like him. She sees a lot of dad in me, she tells me. That kind of makes me feel good. The boys had a really good father, very good father. And I'm really sorry that I wasn't around, right? I actually did assignments. I've done assignments in school about the Ocean Ranger. And I learned a lot from that, like things I figured I need to know, you know what I mean? And learn more about my father as a result of these projects. I'm happy, I'm glad I did them.
David was one of three, well, we had six children, but he was the second oldest boy. And he was very, very quiet, quieter than some young people, even when he was a kid. Eh? And he was interested in school, whatever he did. He always wanted to, you know, to prove himself. And very shy type. And as he got older, he liked the woods. He used to rabbit hunt, and he liked out in boats.
Stephen, the youngest, he was only 18, and I guess he was barely old enough to actually go to work. He worked in the kitchen first off, you know, but he was eager to go out and go to work and make some good money for himself, you know. And so he was just a hard-working young fella, you know, wanted to make a good living for himself. And he liked the time off, which was, loved to go hunting and fishing, you know, so he kind of liked the time off for that reason, which was good. And Robert, he was a bit more outgoing. He had just come out of the army and had been around, you know, for a few years. And of course, he was a bit older and, you know, probably the hardiest of our family. And again, didn't mind the hard work, you know, so when he went out to that, he actually got on as the, I'm with the drilling crew right off the bat. And, you know, he's a big young fella, and that's kind of what they wanted at that time, you know.
I know he used to do a lot of things, actually, that I like to do. You know, I like to be outdoors and go for a trout every now and then and stuff like that, you know. That's what he used to do. I wish I could have met him, like, really. It made a big difference. So I didn't know him at all, you know. I know enough to know what kind of person he was. I probably know enough to be able to have a conversation with him, you know. And that time will come.
I remember her telling me that when I was born, because my birthday is 4 days before my dad's, his is December 10th, and I remember her saying that I was such a good birthday present for my dad, because she brought me home from the hospital and just in time for his birthday.
I'd be working in the nighttime. I'd climb up the derrick. I was a derrick hand at that time, so I could look across, and it was maybe 6 or 7 miles away. I could see the ranger was all well lit up. I knew at that time they were over there, you know, so I'd be climbing up lots of times in the derrick and looking over and just wondering what they were doing.
Well, I have this picture at home, and it's my dad and I with my grandmother, and he's holding me up in his arms with this yellow sweater on, and he's touching my leg. And I was just looking at that photo the other day, and it was just really weird because I just touched my leg and thought, oh my God, my dad touched my leg. That's the only thing that I can kind of connect with my dad. So it's a powerful picture, and I mean, I want to keep looking at it, so that's the only way I can remember my dad.
Last time I saw him, I believe he was getting ready to go to St. John's to take the flight, to go to the rig. And I believe it was in the evening. And he was driving around looking for us, I guess, to say goodbye. And I was on Skidoo at the time. And he found me and said goodbye then. And just a hug and a kiss, and we'll see you next time, or we'll see you soon. Something like that.
I was home that evening, and we had supper. And I had a meeting that evening, and he was leaving practically the same time. And we said our goodbyes, and he had said to me, I got another half hour yet, so I got a book here I'm going to finish. So he sat down when I was leaving, and he read the book and left it on the coffee table. And the name of the book, I said, gave me chills after it was Ghost Rig. It's an oil rig on the cover, and all the men in the story lose their life in this book, in this story.
Well, it's still pretty tough for me. But it's tough for the whole family. I mean, we have Robert's birthday is December 25th. And we have to go to it every year. My mom's birthday is February the 14th. So she has lived through that every year.
I remember every single year in elementary school, we used to make Father's Day cards. You know, obviously everyone still makes those. But every time we had to make those in like art class, you know, someone would always say, you know, Danielle doesn't have a dad. You know, and the teacher would say, well, she can make it for her uncle. I didn't want to make it for my uncle. It wasn't my dad.
I'm sure she never got over the grief because when she remarried, I'd went to their house, and sure enough, there was a photograph of the Ocean Ranger and a picture of Randy and Roz, their wedding day. Even, you know, we sitting right next to her husband, and here's the picture right there. So I said to myself, now she'll never forget him, you know, never.
Watching this, you know, show about, you know, after afterlife, and how some people come into the room and shake the, you know, the bed, and the light bulbs burn out and stuff, and I'm just thinking, how come anything like that hasn't happened to me? But I don't know, maybe my dad would think I was scared or something, but I know that they're looking down on me. I mean, I can get pretty angry because my parents aren't around to support me, so I'm a very independent soul, you know, so. And maybe they're looking down above, you know, thinking, you know, Danielle's got a good head on her shoulders now. She's doing okay. He would have been so scared. And I just wonder, what was he thinking? Was he thinking about me? He just had this newborn daughter, and he was dying. I can only imagine what he was going through, but, and then the cold water, and just floating around, and nobody found him.